Welcome to today's session on the structure of internet. This is the 7th lecture in the series for the web-based technologies and multimedia applications course. Today we will be looking into the entire structure of internet. The structure of internet is non-uniform. It is not one and the same at every place. It travels through different places. And when we say places, it is not essentially that it just travels over the ground or under the ground, but it also travels under the sea. There are new technologies that are in advent, and the structure of internet has been changing rapidly as more and more technologies are coming into the picture. So the objective of today's lecture is to learn the structure of internet. As discussed earlier, internet is a global connection of networks. But how are these computers connected? Internet is basically built up of multiple smaller networks called subnets. Each computer system on a subnet must have a unique IP address. All these subnets are connected together with network devices called routers, and each subnet may also contain its own subnets. Now let's have a look at the image. It shows the top level view of the structure of internet as a cloud of many routers that are connected to each other. You may be able to connect the internet to any of the search engines or any of the web servers like Igno web server. Though you are connecting from your browser, you might not be knowing the route it takes for establishing the connection. There are many alternative routes. Your device as a client may be part of the local area network, wide area network, or any other wireless network. It does not matter. But everything is almost in the internet cloud. Why? Because all these networks use one common protocol for reliable data transfer. So they speak common language and communicate irrespective of physical differences. The image shows the structure of internet, wherein you can see clients on the local area network connected to internet through router and web server connected to internet through router. The basic communication protocol on internet is the TCP/IP, which we discussed in depth in one of our earlier presentations. In short, this is called TCP/IP. This protocol ensures reliable delivery of information from one source identified by a unique IP address to a destination also identified by a unique IP address. Please note that the source and destination computers may either be local or remote computers depending on the destination location. But then what are these IP addresses? We discussed about IP addresses also earlier, but then we will discuss it a bit more now. Of course, we will answer this particular question a bit later, but to connect to a physical network, all devices irrespective of wide or wireless use an interface card called NIC. NIC stands for Network Interface Card. An interface card may have its own unique physical address. However, you cannot locate a device just by its unique physical address, as these addresses do not provide any indication about the location of the device. Thus, you require a protocol that uniquely identifies a device on the internet. TCP and IP are the two core protocols of the internet protocol suite. The TCP primarily provides the reliable delivery of stream of bytes from a computer or a program to another computer or a program. It breaks the data stream into packets at the source and makes sure that all the packets are assembled orderly at the destination. The IP protocol, on the other hand, identifies the location of source and the destination. Any computer on internet is identified by its unique IP address. Two standard versions of internet protocol are available. Internet protocol version 4 is one among them, which in short we call IPv4. An IPv4 address is a 32-bit address. Now let's have a look at the image. Here 192.168.1.97 is an IP address. IPv4 address is a series of four numbers separated by dots. The four numbers range between 0 and 255. So IPv4 address takes only 4 bytes of a computer memory. It means that in total, an IP address under IPv4 takes 32 bits. Not all the IPv4 addresses may be used to identify a computer. Some addresses of IPv4 are not used at all due to certain restrictions. In addition, some addresses are reserved. For example, the IP address 255.255.255.255 is used for broadcasts. Every device, computer, printer or peripheral connected to a TCP IP network must have its own IP address. Each 32-bit IP address consists of two components, net ID and device ID. Net ID means network identifier ID. It identifies one of the networks that is part of the internet. Device ID, it identifies a specific device within the identified net ID. Every time when a computer is connected to network, it may acquire a unique dynamic IP address or a static IP address. A net ID may be of 8 to 24 bits long. By using a subnet mask in combination with their own IP address, one can determine the destination address of the devices as remote or local. For example, consider the IP address 192.168.1.35 having 24 bits NID, net ID. The remaining 8 bits of this address specifies the device ID. The subnet mask for this network should be 255.255.255.0. This subnet mask is used to identify the IP address of the network. The subnet mask is similar to an IP address. It is also a 4-byte field and can be represented using dot notation. In binary, it always consists of a series of ones followed by a sequence of zeros. The total number of bits are 32, but the number of ones and zeros determine the nature of the mask. By comparing any IP address with a given mask, one can split addresses into two parts, a network ID and a device ID. Let's have a look at the image. It shows the use of subnet mask. By comparing the source network ID with the IP address of the source and the network ID of the destination IP address, one can easily determine if the destination is within the same subnet. So a web page request can be identified as a local page or a page from a remote server. As the number of users are increasing, IPv4 addresses will run short. In fact, they are already running short. Nowadays, one is getting IPv6 address but not an IPv4 address. So a 64-bit internet protocol version 6, which in short can be called IPv6, was designed, which is at present actively being deployed on the internet. Internet is one of the most incredible inventions created by the mankind. What started as a small network of nearby computer servers sharing information grew into a worldwide phenomena that has changed how we get about our daily lives. At this point in human history, internet is the best medium to communicate. It has the capability to deliver data to a single device at very high speeds. Almost 4.57 billion people were active internet users as on April 2020, which means that 59% of the global population were active internet users. So internet has to be a robust, reliable and streamlined system to transfer data. Now let us see how data moves through the internet. Data is split into bits called packets. Each packet travels through the internet via a series of checkpoints. Let's try to track the journey of data through internet. Whenever data is transmitted through the internet, that information can't just go somewhere. Instead, it has to be broken down, directed, and reassembled. First, the data sent is broken into packets or small data files that travel roughly at 2/3 of the speed of the light. As you all know, the speed of the light is 3×10⁸ meters per second. So it is traveling at least at 2/3 of the speed of the light. That is the traveling velocity of the transmission. So that data travels at very high speeds. That does not mean that data is transmitted that quickly, though bandwidth, traffic and other factors can increase latency. Bandwidth is how much data can move through a cable. Traffic is how many other data packages or data packets are traveling in a cable. Then router uses a transmission control protocol to direct packets to their destination. But there is one problem. TCP is not good at actually sending packets. It can write an address on an envelope, but it can't actually deliver the envelope. That's why modem uses IP, that is internet protocol, to send packets. In other words, if TCP and IP worked in an office building, TCP would sort the mail in the delivery room and IP would deliver it throughout the building. With these two protocols working together, packets can finally traverse the internet. One very important thing is that the packets, when they are sent, they are not going to take the same route. So if we track the route of one packet, it doesn't mean that all the packets are traveling in the same route. The thing is that at least 15-20 people were told that you reach a particular destination, that's it, and they were told to reach by a particular time, and how they travel, it hardly matters. So if you find one traveling by air, it doesn't mean that all the remaining 19 are also traveling by air. Each one can take their own route, and of course there can be 20 different routes for 20 people to reach the destination. However, there is a bit of difference in the way data is transmitted in the form of packets. Packets, when they reach the destination should know which is the first packet to be read and which is the second packet to be read. In short, I have to say that the order of the packets is very important. That is the reason why we have a protocol in place, and there will be a format for each packet, and each packet format will include the information about its particular place in the entire stream of packets that are received at the destination. In fact, a number of things happen while the packets are traveling from one point to another point. They go through different routers, they go through different gateways, many protocols get applied so that no misinterpretation of the packet takes place, and ultimately they reach the destination and they are reassembled in such a way that whatever the sender's intention is or whatever the sender is sending, the same is received by the destination. So all these things are going to take place, and of course we find that once we send something, it's just received in no time. Of course, if one asks how much time it takes, you have to just tell only in few seconds, but sometimes even less than 2 seconds or even 1 second. But the thing is that number of things happen in that very, very little time. It's not that it disappeared here and appeared there. After the modem, packets go to the local internet service provider, which directs it to the long haul provider. Then packets go through the gateway and to a collection of enormous data exchange hubs. Then the packets go to the destination's long haul provider and the local internet service provider. So packets also move through the modem and router of the destination location before getting reassembled. Once reassembled, the information we sent finally arrives at the destination device, and our friend can see and read the message. Of course, that's not exactly the route that your data takes every time you use the internet. It's just one of the countless other possibilities. So the way you sent will be the way it is received. When we are sending it, whenever it reaches the internet service provider and whenever it is put on the long haul network, the same is happening in reverse when it is reaching the destination. that the long haul provider is putting it on your local ISP, who is ultimately passing it to the destination. The point is that no matter how quickly we can see information online, that data has a long way to go. The internet's DNS associates IP addresses with specific names. DNS stands for domain naming system. So whenever we are typing an address in the web browser, basically it is converted into the IP address. And basically how it is converted, whenever we type the address, it goes to the DNS. DNS will be having a mapping of this particular address to the corresponding IP address, and that IP address is the one which is going to be worked upon and is being looked into, and ultimately that destination with that particular IP address will be contacted and the requested information will be loaded. It permits us to type URLs in browser without typing the IP address, but DNS needs its own infrastructure to function. It can't just exist because we want to see domain names. As a result, domain naming system has hundreds of different servers that empower the world's domains. These servers are unevenly split into zonal authorities that serve global, local IPv4 and IPv6 traffic. Global traffic is for requests that require data from a long distance. Local traffic is for requests nearby. Servers that use IPv4 serve current generation websites that were registered before the emergence of IPv6. IPv6 is the next generation of website IP addresses that allow for more numerical combinations and as a result more websites. IPv6 was built exclusively to serve the growing number of websites on the internet. All of these servers need to connect in order for the internet to function. And since Earth is mostly water, more than 500,000 miles of cable was laid throughout the world's oceans. These cables are massive and they are responsible for international data transmissions. There are undersea cables which help connect to internet. These cables have fiber optics inside that are responsible for transmitting actual data. But the fibers only make up a fraction of the thickness of a submarine communication cable. The rest of the cables are made of protective materials. The undersea cables are wrapped up in several layers of protective materials to avoid degradation, higher pressure, and other living beings such as sharks and other animals that may damage the cable. Then we have IEPs. They are internet exchange points. IEPs are massive data hubs that process and direct packets of information. At any given second, they are moving gigabits of data, shooting it around the world with pinpoint precision. Now, let us see some projects details, and these projects are trying their best to reach those areas which are not covered by internet. And also, there are several projects in the world whose aim is to provide internet access during those times when you can't get due to some natural calamities such as a tsunami or such as an earthquake and other incidents. So it is not that there are mobile towers that we are able to see when we are standing, and these mobile towers can also be made portable. We have several projects where the mobile towers are portable, and wherever there is a need for internet access, the towers are moved to that place. Of course, it is very much easy to move from one place to another place, as of the distances are not important. But at the same time, when one needs to do the same at the time of natural calamities, then it's very, very difficult because you don't have a route which can be used to take the towers. Of course, one is Google's Project Loon. Now, I'll be briefly discussing about this Project Loon, which is very much interesting. What I think is that in case you get any idea how much wild it may be, you need to think about its implementation, because whatever is happening now have born from the wild ideas. Otherwise, never people imagined that they can call a person from anywhere, anytime, and they can also access internet from anywhere, anytime. Of course, when I said anywhere in the case of internet access, yes, in case you have a mobile network operator, you can use your mobile data connection. But it is the mobile which made it possible to do anything from anywhere. So the idea may be wild, but now it's completely sold out, and now things are coming over the internet which are very, very much wilder, and there are people who are making these wild dreams a reality. Now let us see what is this Google's project Luna. Billions of people around the world are still without internet access. Loon is a network of balloons traveling on the edge of the space, delivering connectivity to people in communities who are in remote areas around the world. Loon partners with mobile network operators globally to expand the reach of their LTE service. Together, Loon expands coverage to places that lack it, and it supplements existing networks and provides quick coverage after natural disasters. Now let us see how it works. Delivering connectivity from balloons flying 20 kilometers up in the stratosphere poses a unique set of engineering challenges. To expand connectivity to areas around the world, Loon combines advancements in material science, atmospheric modeling, machine learning, communication systems, and others. Loon has taken the most essential components of a cell tower and redesigned them to be the light and durable enough to be carried by a balloon 20 kilometers up on the edge of the space. Loon balloons are designed and manufactured to endure the harsh conditions in the stratosphere, where winds can blow over 100 kilometers per hour and temperatures can drop as low as to minus 90 degrees centigrade. Balloon is made from sheets of polyethylene. Each tennis court sized balloon is built to last for well over 100 days before landing back on Earth in a controlled descent. All the flight equipment is highly energy efficient and is powered by renewable energy. Solar panels power the system during the day while charging an onboard battery to allow for nighttime operations. Now let's consider flight equipment. Antennas transmit connectivity from ground station across a balloon mesh network and back down to a user's LTE phone. A user needs nothing more than a standard LTE phone to connect to a Loon balloon. Solar panels power the equipment during the day and charge the onboard battery to allow for nighttime operations. The flight capsule holds the electronics that commands and controls the Loon system. A parachute automatically deploys to guide the balloon safely back to Earth after its flight. The custom-built auto launchers are designed to launch Loon balloons safely and reliably at scale. Side panels protect the balloon from the wind as it is filled with lift gas and positioned for launch. The crane is used to smoothly release the Loon balloon up to the stratosphere. In fact, it takes it into the stratosphere. Each crane is capable of launching a new balloon into the Loon network every 30 minutes. Let us see now how the balloons navigate the winds. Loon balloons travel approximately 20 kilometers above the Earth's surface in the stratosphere, well above aeroplanes, wildlife, and weather events. Loon balloons can reach countries around the world from the launch sites. Predictive models of the winds and autonomous decision-making algorithms move each balloon up or down into a layer of wind blowing in the right direction, getting the balloon where it needs to go. The navigation system functions autonomously using algorithms and software, with operators providing continuous human oversight. A group of Loon balloons create a network that provides connectivity to people in a defined area in the same way as a group of towers on the ground from a terrestrial network. The difference is that loon towers are constantly moving with the winds. The software is constantly learning to improve the choreography of the balloons, which improves the quality of the network. The entire network can function autonomously, efficiently routing connectivity across balloons and ground stations while taking into account balloon motion, obstructions, and weather events. Loon's greater coverage area enables mobile network operators to expand their coverage where it is needed. Loon transmits an operator signal from connection points on the ground, beams it across multiple balloons in the stratosphere, and then sends that signal back to a user's LTE device. It's basically a three-step process. Wireless internet signal is transmitted up for the nearest balloon from mobile network operator who is a partner on the ground using a loon provided ground station. Signal is relayed across the loon balloon network. Users standard LTE handsets connect to the mobile network through the loon balloons. Loon maintains continuous telemetry and command links with every balloon, tracking the location using GPS. There are also other projects from Facebook and others who are constantly working towards the projects which will lead to internet access for people who doesn't have. Facebook's Aquila drones program, SpaceX satellites program, OneWeb's satellites program are similar, and they are working in the similar areas. Of course, when I say similar, it doesn't mean that they are perfect. They are different, but their ambition is to provide internet access to those people who are deprived of it. So thank you very much for joining me in today's session. In case you have doubts or any questions, please feel free to mail me on pvsuresh@ignoo.ac.in. Thank you very much.